In this tutorial, we are going to focus on creating character concept art from photo reference in Photoshop. Now, I'm going to create a quick thumbnail in Sketchbook. Regardless of what our drawing skills are like, we want to do some kind of thumbnail to have an idea of what we're creating. Once we have that concept, then we're going to step into Photoshop to start editing. So we switch to Photoshop, and we'll see that I've got a character posed and ready to go. And I'm going to use this as my template for the character art. I'm going to take my photo reference and lay it on top of this body. Now, I've used a 3D model that I already have. If you don't have one, use a photo. They'll do the same thing. So here I've got some photo reference, a bikini top that I found on the internet. And the goal is to change it and alter it to fit our base template. And we're going to be using a lot of the same tools, everything under this Edit Transform menu that we see right there. So I'll use Edit Transform Scale and Rotate to fit it to the shape of my template. I'll also adjust the opacity of the layer to make it easier to see the photo reference on top of my template. And I'm just trying to fit it so that it looks like it forms itself around the character's body. Now let's look at Edit Transform Warp. This will create a lattice around our photo reference that allows us to push and pull and change the photo reference in a non-linear way. So we can kind of squash it and stretch it to fit our character's body a little bit better. Warp will come in really handy. It's very useful. We're also going to use layer masks extensively. So layer mask, reveal all. This will basically apply an alpha channel to our layers so that we can mask parts of it out. And this will become crucial for blending our photo reference into our template's base shape. Now the edit tools and the layer masking will get us pretty far, but we're going to need to do more. Here's an example here where I'm taking the same bikini but a different image of it, and I'm going to reapply it onto my template so that I can get optimum coverage on the model so that it doesn't look like I have any gaps. So here's a good example where our photo reference can fit better. The bikini on the right isn't adhering to the shape of the breast. So now I'm going to use one of our other crucial tools, which is under the Filter menu, Filter Liquify. And Liquify is a soft modification tool. We select that brush at the top, and then we can affect our photo reference layer within the radius of that brush. So with Liquify, we can reshape our photo reference with even more precision than we can with the Warp tool. So Liquify will come into play quite a few times during this tutorial. So those are our basic tools, the Edit Transform tools, the Liquify that we just looked at, and the Layer Masking. So let's do it all again on the shorts. We're going to wrap the shorts around the body the same way that we did the bikini. We're going to start by using the Edit Transform menu, and usually Edit Transform Distort can do most of the work that we need. So I'll use Edit Transform Distort to generally shape the photo reference to my template. I'll use the Warp tool to fine-tune that fit. And again, it's helpful to lower the opacity on the layer so that we can see both the template body underneath and the photo reference while we're working with it. So next, I'll either erase or layer mask out the skin detail. I know that I'm never going to need that because I have skin on the base template, so I can safely get rid of it. And now I need to cross the legs on my photo reference the way that my base template is. So I'm not going to be able to do that with warping or liquify, so I'll use my lasso tool to select part of the leg of the short, and then I'll use the liquify tool to push it into shape. And we'll see that that gets it, you know, most of the way there, but I am going to have to cut it, control X, and then paste it onto its own layer so that I can make changes to it. And by doing that, now I can push it under the other layer. It gets a natural overlap. It feels much more like shorts should feel. And with that, now I'm at the point where I can make global changes. I can make the final adjustments with the Edit Transform Warp tool. So I can lower the waistline and I can fit the shorts to the hips of my template a little bit. Next up is her shoulder rig. We're going to use Edit Transform and then Flip Horizontal. We'll use the flip a few different times. We want to know where it is. It's in the Edit Transform menu. And now I want to mask out some of these areas that I'm not using. So I want to get rid of the black. And to do that, I've used my Quick Select tool, which is the fourth tool down on the left, it allows me to pretty intuitively select different areas of color on the photo reference. And so I can quickly cut out the parts of that image that I don't need so that I'm left with just the shoulder rig. And then I can use my edit, transform, warp to fit it into shape. And I'll do the exact same thing with the belt around her hips. Edit, transform, warp, and distort to get into the general shape. And then either layer mask or erase the details that I don't need. Layer mask is a safer choice because if I make a mistake, I can always just paint over it and undo it. Okay, time for another new tool. Image, adjustments, match color. What match color will do is it will take one layer, it will look at the colors on a separate layer, and it will make my layer match that separate layer. So by using match color, I can make the side pouch match my belt a little bit more closely. In order to do this, I do have to adjust the image properties down below. I need to tell Photoshop which image I want to use. In this case, there's only one open. And then I need to point it to the correct layer. And then there are a few tools to tweak the color changes. And by doing that, I can very quickly change the color of several different layers to match each other. Now, match color won't always work, as we saw with the shoulder rig on her chest. I'm trying to use the image adjustments levels tool to brighten it up and then attempt to use match color, but the chest belt is just a little bit too dark for us to successfully match color. So I'm gonna have to change the color manually. And I've added a new layer on top of the belt layer. I've painted it with a brown that matches the waist belt, and I'm going to change the layer blend mode, which is what you just saw me do there. I've switched it to hue, and then I'll try color, and maybe a few other options like screen and soft light. In this case, I'm going to stick with screen and just lower the opacity of that brown layer a little bit. And so this will brighten up the chest belt, and it'll simultaneously color it so that it matches the other belts a little bit. All right, now on to the coat. We see that I have a few different reference pieces, and once again, I'm using my edit, transform, warp, and other edit, transform tools. I've split the coat into two separate layers, and I'm erasing the parts of the coat that I don't need. In this case, it's the sleeves. I'll use the warp tool to wrap the coat around the body, and then I'll use my lasso to grab these arms from this other coat and match them to my body template. No surprises here. Edit, transform, warp once again. I'll quickly duplicate the layer by using my move tool and holding down Alt while I move the layer. That'll make a duplicate. And then I will just cut it up, move it around, use Liquify and warp to fit this sleeve to the other arm. And I'll end up with sleeves that are red on a jacket that's yellow. I try and use the match color on the jacket to make it red. That didn't quite work well enough. Instead, I'm going to use hue saturation, image adjustments, hue saturation. And I can play around with the hue slider to make the coat just a little bit more red. Once I've switched it to red, then I can use match color on the sleeves and match the sleeves to the body of the coat instead of vice versa. So onto the boots. These start off the same way that everything else does. Edit, transform, warp, and some Liquify. With the boots, we're going to end up doing a lot more painting because we don't have image reference that matches the perspective of our template very closely. So you'll see that I'm duplicating lots of different pieces, and then at the end, I'm drawing in detail by hand to make sure that I've got something that matches the body template as opposed to using the reference very literally as is. So if we can't get perfect reference, we need to be able to change our reference using a tool like Liquify to match our body template, or we're gonna have to figure out how to draw in new detail wherever it's missing. All right, I'll add a little bit of blue to the legs for a splash of color, and then we're gonna turn our attention to hair. And you'll see that I have a picture of Gwen Stefani here from the internet, and I'm gonna immediately paint her out so that we just have the hair. And hair is difficult to mask out. It's going to be sloppy. Just go for it. Use the eraser with a soft brush and a low flow to just blend it in as well as you can. And once we have something that's kind of masked out, then we can start to adjust the perspective and distort it so that it starts to fit our character's head a little bit better. So with hair like this, part of it is laying in the reference as we've seen before, but another part of it is layering it with multiple bits of reference. So I've got more than one piece of hair reference here that I'll mask out, and layering these bits together is what creates an interesting hairstyle for a character like this. So I've chosen a hair reference that's relatively similar in color. That'll make it a lot easier to blend. And then I'll position these layers on top of each other to try and get something that feels like a little bit more interesting than just taking one image and laying it on top. So we do want to keep these as very distinct, separate layers. This means that we can alter them separately. This also means that we can reposition them. So I can move one up or down in the stack to cover up other bits or hide under other bits. I'll use all the other tools that I've used so far. So I'll use match color to adjust the different samples of hair so that they match each other. I'll duplicate different pieces, parts, and rotate them around so that I end up with something interesting. And then I want to turn my attention to shading. So a lot of what is going to unify the look of our concept is adding shadows onto the surface of our character and to the photo reference that we've created. So you saw that I just added a little bit of a shadow from the hair onto her face, and that immediately makes the hair and the face feel more solid. It feels like they're interacting with each other. And creating that kind of blending is something that we want to do in general. But first, let's make her hair blue. So the same way that I recolored the belt on the chest, I'm going to add a new layer on top of the hair layers and play around with the blending modes of that. So hue, color, overlay, soft light. Eventually we'll find one that we like to get whatever effect that we're going for. And it'll create something a little bit more different and interesting than just using photo reference as is. Once I have the blue hair, I'm going to start adding some shading to it. I'll create a new layer and I'll paint with a darker blue, and I'll set that layer blend mode to multiply. And you'll see that where I paint that darker color, we get something that's a little bit more shadowy. It's important to use a color that is related to the surface that we're painting on. So blue hair gets blue shadows. I'll add a little bit of a blue shadow to her face to make it look like the hair is reflecting onto the surface of her skin. But now let's turn our attention to adding shading to the rest of the character in general. Again, shading and lighting is going to be very important for creating the overall effect. We have a bunch of different photo references, all with different lighting. We need to unify that. So we're going to pick a direction that the lighting is coming from. We're going to put shadows on one side and we're going to put light on the other. So the light is coming from the left side of the canvas, which means areas on the right of the character should generally be shadowed. And I'll just create a new layer for each area that I want to add shadow in. I'll choose a color that's related to the surface that I'm painting on, and I'll add a multiply blend mode. I can also use things like drop shadow and outer glow, like you just saw me use, to add shadow to the character, but generally we're going to be painting it by hand. So I've got a new layer, I'm painting in a dark color on top of the surface of the character, and I'm just trying to create shadows that feel like they match wherever the light is supposed to be in our scene. While I'm creating these shadows, I also want to pay attention to the relationship between objects. So the legs are close together, that's going to create some shadow. The jacket is sitting above the character's chest, that'll create some shadow. The bikini is above the character's chest, there'll be some shadow there. So I'm not just creating shadow based on the placement of the light, I'm also creating shadow based on the proximity of objects to one another. This kind of interaction between objects is what really sells the concept as a cohesive whole, as opposed to looking like a collage of different images that we've just slapped together. Now I'll start to do tinier and tinier details. So I want to start big, doing the shadow across the entire arm or the entire side of the body. And then I'll start to narrow my focus, so the shadow on the side of the belt loop or the shadow along the edge of the bikini until I have something that I feel like covers the entire surface of the character. Now, in some areas, I'll need shadow that feels darker than other areas. I'll want to do that on its own layer so that I have control over these even darker shadows versus the base layer of shadows. I can also use this layer to dim areas that are too bright. So if I have something that feels like it's a little bit too shiny, maybe there was a little bit too much flash in the photo that we used, we can use our multiply layer to darken areas like that until we have something that works. And then after we've darkened things, we'll want to brighten things. So the brighten process will be the opposite of the darkening, where we are adding shadows. We're going to think about where the light is in the scene, and we're going to paint bright areas that agree with where that light is affecting the character. So this will be another new layer. I'll paint usually using a bright color like white or a pale yellow or a pale blue, and I'll apply that as a screen or an overlay or a soft light layer. And you'll just have to play around with the different blend modes to see which one works best for your concept. So the lighting pass is absolutely the most important pass for this style of character concepting. We really want to focus a lot of attention creating good shadows and good highlights on the surface of our character. So that's it for the character. Now we could just spend time with the presentation of the character and the background and details like that. And that's it for this tutorial. Took a look at taking regular photo reference from the internet and make it into a character concept. No drawing required. Gotta love it.